acute epidural hemorrhage, or also called extradural hemorrhage. What is epidural or extradural hemorrhage? We all know that the skull is lined by this blue line, which is the dura, and the bone of the skull is adherent to the dura, and the dura in contact with the inner surface of the skull bone. If bleeding occurs between the bones of the skull and the dura, with collection of hematoma, this is called epidural hemorrhage or extradural hemorrhage. From its name, extradural, because the hemorrhage outside the dura. This is the dura, and this is inside the dura, and this is outside the dura. Hematoma outside the dura is called extradural hemorrhage. Why it is also called epidural hemorrhage? Epi means just above, and this hematoma is just above and just outer to the dura. Therefore, it is also called epidural hemorrhage. What is the incidence of this condition? This condition usually affects the anterior branch of middle meningeal vessels, because the anterior branch of middle meningeal vessels pass in this region, which is the side of the head. And in the side of the head here, there is a thin temporal bone, and any trauma to the side of the head leading to fractures of the temporal bone or parietal bone with injury of the anterior division of middle meningeal vessels. This is the middle meningeal vessels enter the skull through the foramen spinosum. Once the middle meningeal vessels enter the skull, it divides into posterior division, pass backward, and the anterior division. The anterior division pass on the side of the head in the region of the pterion. What is the pterion? It is the H-shaped junction between frontal bone, the blue color, the green color is parietal bone, and the yellow color, which is temporal bone, and the reddish color or rose color, which is the greater wing of sphenoid. And this H-shaped junction is the pterion. Here the anterior division pass in a bony canal, and here the bone is thin. Therefore, any trauma to the side of the head easily fracture here the bone, and injury of the anterior division of middle meningeal vessels. The etiology of this injury is usually trauma, blow to the side of the head. When the trauma occurs to the side of the head, it may lead to co-injury or counter-co-injury. What is the meaning of co-injury or counter-co-injury? If you receive trauma here in the right side, leading to fracture of the bone of the skull, and the fracture leading to injury of the vessels between the bone of the skull and the dura, on the same side of the trauma, this is called co-injury. But there is a strange trauma. You receive trauma on the right side, but the hemorrhage occur on the opposite side, in the left side. Why? Because trauma to the right side will leading to push the brain to the left side. And during recoil of the brain from left to the right, This lead to stripping of the dura from the bone on the opposite side. And during stripping of the dura from the bone on the opposite side, in between there is the middle meningeal vessels. With tearing of the middle meningeal vessels on the opposite side, and this is called contercoup injury. The bleeding may be arterial, bleeding due to injury of middle meningeal artery, or it may be venous bleeding. Venous bleeding from where? Venous bleeding may be from the diploic veins. Diploic veins mean the veins of the bones of the skull. Because we all know that the outer table and the inner table of the skull are called diploe. And in between, the vessels are called diploic vessels. Therefore, venous bleeding may occur due to injury of diploic veins or injury of the venous sinuses or dural venous sinuses or injury of middle meningeal vein. Venous injury is much more common than arterial injury because the veins has thin, weak wall with more liability for injury more than the arteries. What is the pathology of middle meningeal hemorrhage? Once the patient received trauma to the side of the head, this leading to movement of the brain inside the skull. And we all know that movement of the brain inside the skull, this lead to a stage of concussion. The beginning is a stage of concussion. In concussion, there is inhibition of the vasomotor center, leading to low blood pressure. And the low blood pressure leading to, in spite of the arteries or the vessels are teared, but due to low blood pressure, bleeding doesn't occur. This is the stage of concussion. The vessels are injured, but not bleed due to low blood pressure in concussion. Once the patient recover from concussion, the blood pressure rises. Due to rise of the blood pressure after recovery from concussion, bleeding start. But manifestations of intracranial hemorrhage doesn't appear from the start. Why? Because the hematoma needs time to collect. And the hematoma needs time to strip the dura from the bone. And the hematoma needs time to be large enough to compress the venous drainage of the brain. And once the venous drainage of the brain compressed, congestion of the brain, edema of the brain will start manifestations of brain compression. Therefore, there is a time needed for the hematoma to strip the dura, to collect, to enlarge, to compress the venous drainage, to produce congestion and edema, and this time needed by the hematoma is called lucid interval. Once the hematoma collects, the hematoma collects upward, outward, and downward. The hematoma collects and enlarged upward. Over what? Over the cerebral cortex. And the cerebral cortex here in the side of the head is area 4, the origin of the motor area 4, which is the origin of pyramidal tract. The hematoma enlarged downward, in this fossa, enlarge downward in this fossa in the middle cranial fossa. The hematoma occur here. This is the region of the arterium. Therefore, downward into the middle cranial fossa and upward over the cerebral cortex area 4 and outward. Leakage of blood through the skull outward, leading to collection of hematoma under the temporalis muscle. This is the lucid interval. Finally, brain compression, a stage of brain compression, occur due to many factors. First of all, early compression occurred due to compression of the venous drainage of the brain, leading to cerebral congestion and cerebral edema. Cerebral congestion and cerebral edema leading to manifestations of brain irritation. Later on, the high intracranial tension will compress all parts of the brain and compress the arterial supply of the brain. Increased intracranial tension leading to herniation in two sites. What is the herniation? First, herniation occurs through this foramen, which is called tentorial hiatus. This is a famous fold of dura mater called tentorium cerebelli. Tentorium cerebelli. The tentorium cerebelli has a free border, which is U-shaped. To give this foramen in the tentorium, which is called tentorial hiatus. Normally through the subtentorial hiatus pass the midbrain. Due to increased intracranial tension by the hematoma, the hematoma push the temporal loop, push the temporal loop into the tentorial hiatus. This is the tentorium cerebelli, and this is the foramen is the tentorial hiatus. The temporal loop is pushed into the tentorial hiatus beside the midbrain, leading to compression of the midbrain and the compression of the cranial nerve passing in the tentorial hiatus. What is the cranial nerve passing in this hiatus? The third cranial nerve, oculomotor nerve, which supplies the constrictor pupillae. Therefore, compression of the midbrain and compression of oculomotor nerve, third cranial nerve, leading to pupillary changes which occur in brain compression and paralysis of cerebral function due to compression of the tracts from the cerebral cortex to the lower centers in the bones, medulla, and the spinal cord. This is the first type of herniation, which is herniation of the temporal loop through the tentorial hiatus. The second herniation, which occurred due to high pressure by the hematoma, this may compress the cerebellum from above downward, compress the cerebellum downward into this foramen. What is this large foramen in the skull? This is the foramen magnum. Therefore, cerebellar herniation into the foramen magnum will compress what? In the foramen magnum, buzz the lower part of the medulla, containing the vital centers. Therefore, herniation of the cerebellum into the foramen magnum will compress the vital centers in the lower part of the medulla. Finally, terminal compression. With this, what is terminal compression? temporal loop herniation completely destroying the midbrain. Severe compression of the midbrain with destruction of the midbrain leading to what is called decerebrate rigidity. Compression of the midbrain, you separate the cerebral cortex and the hemispheres above and the lower centers in the bones, the medulla and the spinal cord below. Like you cut the cerebral hemispheres. This is called decerebrate rigidity due to compression of the midbrain with separation of the upper centers from the lower centers in the CNS, leading to moment of generalized rigidity and death. This is the etiology, pathology of epidural hemorrhage or extradural hemorrhage. Thank you for good listening and good luck, and we'll continue the clinical picture and treatment in the next video. Thank you.